other, and the question of financial matters.
In other words, they had certain subject areas that they were interested
in. They thought it would be helpful to develop monographs covering various spaces of history. Most of them were very poor to me. They were not something that you cared about keeping. Mm-hmm. They either were poorly done or were slanted and unfetched. We just never did anything with it.
They still exist as a part of that remnant of files that's out there in Tacoma.
They're still in the files.
I think it would be very useful to me if I could get access to those materials this winter when I'm going to be out west, just to see what's there if I can, and avoid repetition of anything in interviews with you and with others.
Well, you could see them, but you'd have to be warned because they were very, very incomplete and defective. Some of them were misleading, I thought.
Superficial.
Superficial and misleading. Yeah. They were done by people working around the edges. The history. They were not done by Nevins or by Heidi or by Hill, and I didn't have much use for them.
Were they done by their research people like Caruso and Kohlmeier and Thomas?
That Kohlmeier did, I thought was good.
Yeah. Well, they must have been done then by people out west who were hired to do this. But you felt that most of this monograph material was much too lightweight or too distorted in its view to be published.
Most of it just wasn't good.
What was good? Do you remember anything besides the biographical sketch of your grandfather by Kohlmeier, which you felt was good?
I'd have to get the stuff out and look at it again. I haven't looked at it. Well, for instance, it filled up the disagreement between the members of the Laird Norton family and our family as policy. Mr. Thatcher, Frank Thatcher, made at some time a statement as either. Or you'd have been hearing that the Weyerhaeuser Timber Company should be liquidated inside of 10 years. This was the statement made back around 1910. Or perhaps earlier. And F.E. thought that was a great exception to that because you couldn't possibly liquidate that property without destroying its value. And there was a question as to did he say it or didn't he, or what do you mean if he did, and that sort of thing.
Well, what was the basis of their quoting Thatcher on this thing? Had they found some document?
In F.E.'s memoirs, he said that he had said.
Oh, I see.
And Laird Bell, for instance, had no recollection of such a thing. So I can't say. I'm sure Andrew Barney said it, but I wasn't there at any time.
Did they get any very substantial memoir from Laird Bell, do you recall?
Did they?
The Columbia crew.
I would guess they did.
Mm-hmm. All of these oral tape recordings have been transcribed, and they're a part of that group of records out in Tacoma, right? All these interviews that were made during the course of the company history.
They're either in Tacoma or elsewhere in the Columbia file. I don't know.
Do you recall under what conditions these interviews were made by Columbia? Were the publication rights reserved to the company exclusively for a period of time, or did Columbia have any rights at all to them? You have a contract which would have covered that, of course.
The contract covers it, but I'm hazy about the details. I haven't looked at it for so long. We worked on it. I worked it out with F. furnished and so on. And I'm just vague about the details. I remember that we paid a given amount of money to have the history written. And that the authors of the history were the final judge of the facts. The differences of opinion were to be worked out if possible by conversation and discussion. But that it was impossible to arrive at an agreement, then the representatives of the company were permitted to put footnotes in the history. There were no footnotes ever put in.
You insisted on no insertion of any footnote of your own.
No. No, they were the authors were very fair about it,
they made accommodation of changes in the text of the manuscript then before publication, in consultation with you.
There were some changes made. For instance, they came out originally. The authors came out with a discussion of the terrible conditions in the logging camps. The logging camps, the food was terrible. The beds were dirty. Four bugs and everything. Well, none of us that have been since the year 50 or 60, when any of us got in the business, were called into like that. Mm-hmm. Maybe that was true in the 1880s in Wisconsin. It certainly wasn't true. It wasn't true in the lifetimes of any of us. I could remember the camps that some called me, all the other time they had, when they had electric lights and char baths, clean blankets and sheets, and talk about food. I never have seen food in a logging camp with us. You couldn't keep men in a logging camp with food. And that goes way back when I was a boy. Yeah.
I think the tradition of good grub went back in the history of logging into the 19th century.
I think so, too.
I think the condition of camps, the bunkhouses, was a somewhat different matter, and it didn't really make, there wasn't any really great change over to the modern camps that you knew in the middle teens. Until about 1906, 7, 8, 9, in that period.
That's right, like that.
And this was not only a matter of the interest and concern of the owners for providing better living conditions for their health. It was indeed a part of the attitude of the men themselves. They rather scorned, fancy digs, as it were. They kind of prided themselves in that old romantic notion that Stuart Holbrook enunciated so well in Holy Old Mackinac. They were a rough-breeded cat,
sure.
And they didn't care for a lot of sheets and pillowcases and all that fancy doodad.
Those were things we argued about, things like that.
Yeah.
Another thing we argued about was there'd be some crack at somebody in the book that would be taken up and built into something big.
Mm-hmm.
Which was really undeserved. I mean, put a black mark on somebody that was carrying on into eternity one of these damn books. And there were some. There were a few changes like that, but they were minor things. None of them were important.
Tell me a little something about how this history got started. Where did the idea stem from? Where did it start? Is this an idea that you had for some time and sold to other members of the family, or how did it get going?
I'm not really sure. We talked about how important it was to have an accurate history written. Because of the fact that there's so much misrepresentation and misstatement. I remember when Rex Black was here. There was a lady who was taking a course in Columbia and submitted as her thesis an article on the Booth County Lumber Commission, in which she stated that Frederick Warehouser, or the Warehouser Company, was a party to the Booth County Lumber Company, and that there had been grave crimes committed where titles were stolen and land was stolen, timber was stolen, with the knowledge of either my grandfather or the company or something like that. And actually, the Warehouser Company never had anything to do with it. And Rex Black protested very vigorously to this lady, told her this was not true. She came back and said the University of Columbia was insisting upon an accurate statement of the facts, but she couldn't take anything out of her book that her out of the thesis that she performed it. He wrote back and said, well, she could put in she wanted to, but the company reserved rights to sue in case of libel, which is all right. It scared the hell out of her, she didn't put me in.
Mm-hmm.
It was untrue. And things like that happened. Many of the things that were said about the forest industry and about our companies, we felt we could be answered. You don't get anywhere if you just keep on talking the same lie over and over again. Like the old story about the man who's going to cut timber through Wisconsin and got a railroad right away and made the right away 20 miles wide. You know, that's kind of a yard going out here. And that's told by various people.
You had had something to do with setting up what was originally known as the Hell Book in the industry.
Well, the man that did that was Billings.
Billings?
C.L. Billings. Billings had run the, was the manager of the Potlatch Forest Incorporated in Louisville. I was going to say that I think it was after Phil, my brother Philip, left to go to the coast in about 1934. The Forest Service, and the industry were the source point. The Forest Service criticizing the industry for its wasteful methods and its destruction of the forest. It was just good, common, healthy practice for the Forest Service to put a good crack in the paper every Sunday that would show pictures of what the forest industry had done. Well, Billings had been in the forest business, and he collected a bunch of this. I remember one of the pictures he got was put in the paper by the Forest Service, and it showed that the title was something to the effect that it was a good example of the terrible, wasteful practices of the industry. Well, he found out, Billings was able to pinpoint where this was. It was a very interesting thing. And this had been a piece of land owned by the Forest Service, which the Forest Service had burned, had logged and burned, in order to plant, to carry on an experiment in the planting of certain kinds of trees there. It was perfectly proper experiments for the Forest Service to make. But the title said it was an example of the terrible practices of the industry. And this was, when this was called to their attention, they admitted it, but said, heck, they could have shown other pictures that were just as bad. It was a very good example from Billy's point of view to put this in because it was absolutely malicious. Well, anyway, what made you hear it mention that?
I've run across it a number of times, and I think you mentioned it to me once.
Did you ever see it?
As a matter of fact, I think in your files there is a few file references to the Hell Book. But I wondered to what extent these things caused you and your brother Phil to think in terms of the need for writing an authentic history of the company that might deal with some of these problems of your public image.
Now that we, I told you, but I think it is, the story is correct about this book that Phillips got out. Mm-hmm. He sent it to every member of Congress. But on second thought, I don't think that was called a helper. I think that was something that led up to the development of the AFPI program. But
NLMA had something to do with it.
I'm telling you, the NLMA or the AFPI got out a book which was called the Hell Book, which collected all of the a great many articles and pictures which described the terrible attitude, public attitude, toward the forest industry. And I think on second thought, that was what we called the Hell Book. Now, no doubt the AFPI has that reflected still.
What I'm striving for here is to get at the point at which, or if you can find it in your memory, the pinpoint where you became, first of all, seriously interested in having a scholarly history done on your company. Did it derive in any part from your association with scholars in the Forest History Society or the Minnesota Historical Society?
Well, the Forest History Society was launched, I would say, in 46.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked a lot about having history written. I think we have been talking a lot about it before that. And I know we talked a lot about it after that. There was a man, and we discussed on the warehouse board, getting it done, and we discussed who might do it. And one of the people we considered was a man who wrote two or three stories. One of them had to do with forest fires, so that, and the other one had to do with
Stewart was his name.
Was that his name?
Mm-hmm.
I think he was a professor, wasn't he a teacher someplace?
I think he was at Cal.
I think so.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody talked to him about it. He was very cagey about it. He didn't want to get sucked in on a whitewashing exercise. That sort of story. And then we thought, we decided to go to Nevins.
Who recommended Nevins to you? Do you recall?
No, I think I went to talk to Nevins in 1952. That's in my diary somewhere.
Mm-hmm. It would be rather interesting to get this detail down somewhere, because I think it's interesting to know how your interest in this whole bit of the scholarly approach to industry history developed over time.
I think that with a bunch of professors at Columbia when I came back from a hunting trip in Scotland in 1952.
When would that have been? In the fall of 52?
Fall of 52, yeah. I've got the date upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see if I can find some other.
Have you read anything by Alan Nevins up to that time that caused you to think he would be a good man?
He had written something on Rockefeller, hadn't he?
Yeah, that's right.
I think I had read various things. I can't recall at this point. I can't recall at this point why I went to that. Now, John must have made a note of that.
Was John an active participant in this whole thing at that time?
Yes, I think he was. Phil and I discussed it a great deal. We were both interested. I think I must have, I remember the time I first met Neville. I met him over in that little place they ate in Columbia. And we sat down and talked about it for a while. I remember I asked him what he charged to do this kind of thing. He said, well, he said, all I get is my salary, $10,000 a year. He said, I don't accept anything other than my salary. He said, if you want me to do this, you should make arrangements with Columbia. And he said, I do it as part of my work for Columbia. That sort of started me. I didn't realize it was going. Well, he was, you know, these people were all leaned over backwards to not be under any obligation, which I admired him for, and yet it was sort of, you know.
But it was your brother Phil and you who took most of the initiative, I take it, in getting this thing organized and financed.
Yeah, I think I was more interested than everybody else, but I know they all went along with it, but they were, yes, I thought as much into it.
How was the project actually financed, and was it done out of company funds or
all the private? The company paid Columbia. $150,000.
Mm-hmm. And
later some more.
You had to put in a supplementary grant.
Well, yeah, and we just put in more, but we couldn't. It wouldn't take anymore.
Mm-hmm.
The thing stalled and out of money.
They ran out of money.
Money, and the last part of the work was done absolutely without authors to get paid for it.
Uh-huh.
That became a matter of pride. That's going.
Mm-hmm.
We could never.
It became stalled in the sense that it wasn't completed on schedule, and therefore they went on working until it was.
It took almost 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Forgotten when that book was published. I'd have to deep back into my files to find out about the origin of the first meeting I had with
Did you seek guidance from anybody here at all locally in regard to these scholars that were being selected to do this work?
I think we talked to the people here. I remember I talked to, Ted Lane. I'm not sure about that, but I know that. What's this man's name today we had lunch with? His English?
Herbert Heaton?
Herbert Heaton was interested in this.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't think it would be. We didn't think he'd be the best equipped to it. Matter of fact, I think we were rather interested in the fact that Nevin writes in an interesting manner. You know, Heidi's stuff is not particularly brilliant or well done, but it's not. It isn't written in a manner as much as Nevin.
I remember having a conference with you in the first few months of the time I was working in the Forest History Society.
Which
then was the Forest Product History Foundation.
Yeah,
this was in the spring of 1952. In which you asked me who there was in the field who might be interested in doing something along this line. And you had mentioned Nevins, and I mentioned a few people, including Heidi and Heaton, and a couple of other business historians who were at Northwestern University at that time.
Well, maybe you're the one to talk to. My memory is a great base, but that's the time when we were...
When you were composing this.
We were trying to make up our mind toward a goal, yeah.
Right.
But I can't remember the reason for things going on right now.
As you look back now over that period of time and the product that these men turned out, and if you could have the time and the opportunity to tackle the job again, what changes would you make in your approach to the whole thing?
Well, in the first place, I think I would ask that whoever undertook it would do it in a certain time limit, to get it done within a certain period of time. Nevins was under great demand that he was being, during the 10 years this thing was being researched and written, he undertook several other rather important jobs. I think he undertook doing something about did he write another book about Rockefeller?
He wrote several other books.
I think he wrote one about Ford here. And I think he was the kind of a man who was impatient, and I think he'd get tired of one thing and he'd jump to something else. And I don't think it did him a bit of work any good. I think this thing, as I think of it today, parts of it are pretty good and parts of it are not good at all. You read it recently?
I haven't read it recently. Last time I read it was about 3 years ago. Would you be inclined, if you did this again, to choose one author instead of two or three?
I'm not sure of that. I'm not sure I would do that. I think you're almost driven. If you've got a man that's well known like Nevins, to permit him to get some help. Mm-hmm. He actually had two people helping him, Heidi and Hill. Mm-hmm. And I did know at one time which parts were done by which. I think the early part of the story is more readable. Mm-hmm. The latter part, there are parts of it that are
when it gets into the more complex economic and financial aspects of the story, this is the area which is taken over by Heidi, right?
I guess.
Where you have the colorful early history and the personalities who were involved in it. You're talking about work that was done principally by Nevins.
Oh, yes, yeah.
And of course, it was in that area that the documentation was, of course, far less complete than in the areas which Heidi took over and took responsibility for researching and writing. The growth of the company, the Potlatch merger, the whole detail of that development, the sales company, all of that would be areas which would be more grist for the kind of thing that Heidi does. Well, this is just background that I thought it would be useful for me to have in regard to my own approach to this thing, but it doesn't begin to get at the personal history that I hope we'll tie into here today a little bit. The emphasis I'd like to put on our interview would be on your personal history, and in particular start out with your recollections, if you will, spend a little time on them, of your boyhood years. Start out by telling us where you were born, where, and so on. Give us the basic data here.
Taking my own history, I was born in Rock Island, Illinois, on January 16, 1895. My father was John Thornton Warehouser. My mother was Nellie Anderson. Was born Nellie Anderson. I had an older sister, Elizabeth, who is now Mrs. F. R. Tipton of Tacoma, and a brother, a younger brother named John Thornton Warehouser Jr., named after my father. I went to the Hill School to, I went to public school in St. Paul, Minnesota, where we moved in, I should say first that we moved from Rock Island in 1900 to Lake Nebagamon, Wisconsin.
How old were you then, Fred?
I was about 4 years old.
4 years old.
4 years old.
Do you have any memories at all of your early childhood in Rock Island?
Yes, I remember living in Rock Island.
What do you recall about it?
I remember little details of the house. I remember my mother. I remember the horses. It's pretty vague.
We lived in a home that had...
We lived in the house. I was born, which is the house that my grandfather acquired and added to when he was a young man.
Was this right in the town itself?
In the town of Rock Island.
You mentioned having horses. I wondered where these...
There was a barn, and we had horses, and it was a regular farm. And there were chickens and cows, and there was a wonderful vineyard, Concord grapes. I remember particularly because my father and his brothers all loved Concord grapes, and they were awesome. We moved from there to Lake Nebagamon in 1900 because my father had a chance to build and run a sawmill up there with and having an interest in the business with his father and Mr. Edward Ruffage. Mr. Ruffage was an old timber crew and a great, great friend of my grandfather. The three of them had equal interest in this company. Father had to borrow the money to buy his interest. And that company was the Lake Nebagamon Lumber Company, and as a result of their acquiring pine lands from the Omaha Railroad in the early days. The timber was small and tight knotted and happened to be the kind of timber that was in great demand in the early 1900s. And my grandfather's father and Mr. Ruffage used to come up there and visit us. And father, being a relatively young man, was being checked up by his two seniors, and the board was out of place or anything was a little bit wrong. Why they speak about it? Father was a very sensitive person, and all this, and I know it was very hard for him. He was very much hurt at times because of a little thing that they speak about.
Was this his first major assignment in?
No, before that, he had run. He had been a manager of the Rock Island Lumber Company. Well, the Rock Island Lumber Manufacturing Company in Rock Island, which manufactured lumber in Rock Island.
Yes.
Well, it's on the site of the Station Door plant.
Yes.
fact, the door plant was outgrowth of the lumber company. It was a considerable part of their production went into the manufacture of fashion doors.